So there's three major components to the system: the sensors, the Android application, and the server DSU, as OpenML likes to refer to it. And the ones, the boxes labeled with an asterisk, are the ones that were added for this application. The others already existed in the existing KL, which were mainly sensors, read sensors, visualize, and there was a data store here that we don't use. But that was basically what we had before. So now we added this observation to the Android project. We added, obviously, the server communication, the triple store, and being able to manage your account, because we're not just uploading this data freely. We want to have it associated with the user and only let that user access the data rather than just anyone who's pulled the data. This is just briefly what how we enhance the Android application. And like the demo, or like the diagram showed, we had some account management stuff so that you can log in and that the account is securely saved on the device for convenience. And then we added an annotation module so that the Android device will read the sensors because it knows more about it than the server, more about data than the sensor does, and then annotate that and then upload it to the server.
Before jumping to annotation part, I also want to highlight that this part, having the username and password, and we can actually, some is a good point, because today also we have already presented this proposal for related to chaos, and one of the points is we want to actually personalize the sensors, right? This is the step forward to that, and we can just use that as we know who is the patient exactly with the user ID, and we can track the patient. So, now for annotation, as we mentioned before, we actually look at the SSN ontology and we found out we don't have the concept we need for annotating for observation. So so we actually try to have the observation types for blood pressure, heart rate, and body weight, and also along with the corresponding sensor output and observation value for each one. This is just the screen part of the rotation ontology. If you want, you can go and look at that. There is something concept we added, and also we added all of the classification for each observation type, basically based on the different rule they have, and like say heavy weight, light weight, normal, or different kind of heart rate, or different kind of blood pressure. I'll explain that in the system way, and all of the actually monitoring the data. So here, actually, for this, we use the rules for sensor observation. We got that from the EasyDI through Surgeon, and thanks. And here is a classification of the blood pressure for adults. So we actually try to basically based on these rules have the perception and figure out what is the, after reading the raw data, we can say, oh, okay, this patient with this user ID, like 70 has like 70 heart rate is a normal, or with like has a slow heart rate, or like different kind of rules, and just apply that to annotate our ride. So here is an example of the annotated data in JSON. As you can see, so we have the heart rate observation, and we have the this pointer actually.
The reason it's in JSON is just for data interchange between the server and the client. So we do store it in RDF once it actually gets to the server.
As you can see, we have like heart rate reading here, and we have like the say this sensor has quality value, like for example 74, and we have like the heart rate value here as a concept, and we can say this actually produced by Android blood pressure monitor. We can for this project use Android, we can use other reader as well. just go to the wiki page in OSIS and we'll see the, we will put all of the description of the project. If you go to the top, yeah, the architecture of the system is there and the project summary, and then we will add the sources as well, the contact information, all of the information you need to start about this project, and we will update you.
So now we'll go on to the demo. Shivaji's gonna be our patient. So just to take a blood pressure reading. And this first link is just to show that the OpenMHealth API has been implemented. It's not exactly fun to look at. It's just a bunch of JSON data. But if you went and parsed it, it would comply to the OpenMHealth data read standard. And while
showing you the things should come here in the front.
The cord has
to be cord. Just needs to come in the front as well. Just yeah, turn it on like that. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, like I said, this is just for to show that the API
questions?
Left me confused. I didn't see the clarity. I know you need someone to
come in. Okay,
but
we have like the
that doesn't look like much
we had the primary word each of us. Like the Android part was his part.
That I got.
The ontology annotation part was my part.
That's not nothing new. I don't know what you did then. That's something you already routinely do.
No, and also
you learn Spartan?
Yeah.
And then as
far as the REST web services, that's a really
good okay. What did you learn?
And then at the end of the day, three of us has to actually work on a Spark work part as well.
What did
you
learn?
I actually, the annotation part, the ontology part, I knew that the Spark build part, I knew that already from before.
What did you learn? What new thing you learn?
This course before, so that's why I knew. Because I actually took the semantic course before. I knew the ontology. I teach the ontology course, the crash course to a student before. So, and I did a Spark book before. So, I did annotation before this open MCAS part.
Okay. Any questions, students? Next.
We already discussed that actually as a future work. Discussed about the future direction. We want to add the other sensors. We want to actually have the sensors for the asthma, for temperature reading those data from that sensor. And also, we are thinking maybe we are working on doing some statistical things on our data because now we are just.
Finding this kind of information on real time during the event of disaster through some generic search engine is really hard. And if we are able to spread this information to some of the coordinator, then it will make his or her job really easy. So this is what I consider as a real value addition of whatever experiments, whatever system I did in this particular project. On evaluation part, I just took 1,000 random tweets from Hurricane Sandy dataset, and we annotated it with our algorithm, and at the same time we had some manual evaluation, and we tried to compute the difference between our system results and results what are evaluated by people. And what we find out was the really good agreement score, that is 70%. So the difference was only 30 tweets out of 100 tweets, which were wrongly annotated or which were which we were not able to detect from set of 100 bits. Okay, so on the demo part, I'll show you the first. I'll show you.
So just go back one. So you got these traits and you're happy about it, right?
Yes. So these are just some examples.
Mm-hmm. What is the contribution of machine learning? What is the contribution of semantics? How can you explain that?
So, I think the contribution of machine learning, what I see in this particular work most, is how can you detect a location from a text? So suppose if you are using the purely semantic way, web-based technologies, and your ontology does not contain, if it's not rich enough, or if it doesn't contain a specific word to describe a place, you will not be able to detect it. So using machine learning, we were able to detect that. And using semantic web technologies, we were able to know that this particular word is basically a place, not only a place, it's basically a city. Not only a city, we can able to detect that it comes under this particular state. Based on that, when we provide our data to coordinator, he can easily get to know that what are the number of requirements under this city, under this particular area. So for that particular problem, I think I saw real contribution of machine learning and semantic.
But what I'm saying is that you need to really isolate the real example. Here, see what I did. Here's what I got. You give me. I got a general description. I didn't get a very any brutal example.
So okay, this example was in this. So if you see this particular tweet. This one. In that, my machine learning parser was able to detect this particular word is a location. And my ontology detected that this is a particular city under this particular state. So, based on that, we are able to group this particular tweet. This
yeah, I think what you want to do is to really use some, way to really convey that.
Yeah, so actually I have a visualization.
Yeah, and then you also want to kind of measure like X percentage of thing I would have met using the keyword, my objective, Y percent of things I could have met using A, and Z using A plus B.
Yeah. That is a really good detailed analysis of this, yeah. Okay, so on the demo part, I'll just, so what I wanted to show was a file which I generated after all the processing what I did on a set of tweets and how that file looks like. So I held it on the location. So that file basically looks like this. It has a tweet and it has the location information. So that's how we get different data regarding related to different types of resources with location. And I'm not able to connect, but I have the video of a front end, which is basically a kind of small modification to Twitter's front end. And this will show how exactly you can visualize the information what have been generated. This is basically that UI where you need to choose the date and it will show you the locations at which the different tweets were being posted. And if you go on one particular location, it will basically categorize this particular tweets in two parts, the seeker part and supplier part. And if you click on any of, so basically these are some keywords which frequently occurred in a set of tweets what have been detected, and based on that, based on these keywords, it's fetching the tweets related to this. So this is something which is tightly bound to the current Twitter's UI, and we need to modify this thing so that it is able to use the data from the file we have generated. Currently it is using the data which is already there in the database, which is generated by crawled tweets. But if you click on any of the particular keywords, so another thing to notice is that we have divided the resources in this kind of color coding. So currently we are analyzing only three kind of resources, food, medical, and shelter. And it means this particular keyword is occurring in a tweet which are more related to food. So, and if you click on that, this particular thing will give you the set of things. So that's what I have.
Two points. Talk to Hemant that I'd like to capture this as a video and also figure out a way to really show what is the technological contribution for the, I could have gotten these tweets with standard techniques, but with these I got these, or
yeah,
this
so
were false, this was true, and do that very clearly, that would be useful, okay? And I'm glad the approach you took of just, you know, presenting differently than just the presentation of the past, that was a nice thing.
Given a set of UMLS codes, how would you map to a particular ICD-10 code? So, my flow of presentation is, first I would like to discuss about what are these cores actually, and then why do we need these cores, and then how are we going to solve the problem that I'm going to discuss. So coming to what are these cores, UML is abbreviated as Unified Medical Language System. It provides a set of files and software which brings together the biomedical vocabulary and all. The main point of, for us being over here is that it provides a standard codes for each and every medical concept. And in the ICD-10, it provides standard codes for each and every disease. Codes for in a very complex way, it provides codes for a disease which is in left lung, and it provides a different code for a disease which is in the right lung. So it provides the codes for each and every disease. So the point being, as opposed to UMLS provides codes for every medical concept. Here ICD-10 provides codes for every medical every disease. So why do we need this ICD-10 codes and all? The first thing being, for healthcare industry, these codes are very vital. And for every medical insurance company, they ask for this ICD-10 codes for the money reimbursements and all. And the other thing being government statistical reports on morbidity and mortality. The second thing, it is mandatory for every healthcare service to give the diagnosis information of a patient in this ICD-10 codes. And the most important thing, there is a deadline for every healthcare industry in the United States of America that before this time you need to completely implement this ICD-10 coding system. So then, how are we going to code a given EMR document annotate a given EMR document against this ICD-10 codes. So before explaining how we are going to do that, let me explain, let us see what are already there. So there was a system which can annotate a given EMR document against the UMLS codes, and there was an ontology which has the hierarchy of all these UMLS codes. So can we build an application on top of these two? So here is my architecture of how we are going to do that. I'll give an abstract, broad sense of how this is being done. The input for my architect for my application is the EMR document. A triples file which is annotated against the UMLS codes, and the chief complaint section. Once you get that document, we have a pre-processed ontology. This is the ontology of all the ICD-10. It's actually an ontology of hierarchy of all ICD-10 codes. And each label in this ontology represents a class, and it has, inside each class, there is a Sparkle query as an annotation. So we'll fire that Sparkle query on this triples graph and see if all the conditions for this particular class are met. If they satisfy this condition, we'll go further one level deeper, and so on. So finally, we'll check whether it is a leaf node. If it is a leaf node, we'll provide that as a billable ICD-10 code.
Now, if it is not the leaf node, would you provide the alternatives and what are the things that are matching, and then that human make a decision?
We have already discussed with the domain expert, who is a Suhas. He told that for some code, it's okay if you just give the non-billable code, which are inside the tree. But for some, it is not. We need to find a strategy of when to give the code or when not to give the code.
How much what kind of explanation, what kind of relevant data can be text can be shown to the coder? So that he or she can decide faster.
This is correct.
You can show here is highlighted text. I can't tell you for sure, but this it appears to me that this is relevant based on this.
And you might be asking, where are we using the technologies that I have described in the previous slide. So here, as I told you guys that we'll be annotating as the UMLS codes. So we'll be using that system which annotates that. And the second one, we'll be using the ontology developed by Sujan and guys, which has all this hierarchy of UMLS codes and all. And the I'll be explaining a little bit about the pre-processing, how we develop the ICD-10 ontology. So we have these are the actual ICD-10 codes. So if you see this, every it's like a tree structure. The codes which are deeper will satisfy all the other codes which are on the which are to its upper level. So building the hierarchical ontology, it's like this. So once this is done, this is the pre-processing step. And one more thing we'll be doing is that we'll be indexing this level of data. That is, we'll be indexing all the codes which are at the level of this E08. That is one more pre-processing step that we'll be doing. And once that is done, I'll just give a walkthrough with some example so that it'll be very clear to you. So here, this is the input for my system, and we have the index. As I have explained to you guys before, this is the index we do in the pre-processing step as well. So, as I told you guys that we'll be getting chief complaint also from the input. Once we get that, we'll check the index for that particular chief complaint. And once we get the code of this particular chief complaint, we'll go into the ontology that we have developed in the previous step. So, to be very clear, these are the codes that are coming from the UMLS, and these are the codes which are actually there in the input file, and this is the ICD-10 code hierarchy. So, once we got this from the index, and we'll check whether all the conditions are satisfied for this code or not, and once we go one level deeper, this is the second level, where we have this as an annotation in that class. So we'll fire this query on the input graph, and since if you can see that since this triple is there in the patient graph, it is satisfied. And then, since it is satisfied, we'll go one level deeper into that. And here this one has this particular Sparkle query. And the thing is that this is not satisfied. So I'll tell you why this one is not satisfied. Because here in the Sparkle query, we have mentioned the code of comma, which is 9421, which is actually correct, saying here it is comma. But the thing is that in the EMR documents, the doctors might not specify the actual comma. He might write, which is a subclass of comma, which is actually this one. Let's say that in our input file, doctor has mentioned this one, which is actually one of the subclasses of comma. So how are we going to get, how are we going to write a Sparkle query to get that information as well? So here is the thing. Because of this hierarchy, we are not able to, that Sparkle query is not satisfied. So this is the Sparkle query which was there before. Now we are going to introduce one more thing. This is the UMLS ontology which was developed by Sujan and all, which has all the hierarchy, that is all the subclasses of a particular. That means it has all this data inside this one. So we'll write a subquery inside the Sparkle asking to give me the to also validate against the subclasses. So since we have included all the subclasses as well, this thing is satisfied, and hence the code is 08.01. This is the simple walkthrough of how the whole system works. And in the example that I have taken, I have mentioned only one disease as a chief complaint. It might have like more than 100 diseases in there, so that it will do this thing. And now coming to the demo. This is a simple UI. Here are the triple files, and I'll show you how actually those triple files are. The files are like this. It has chief complaint in the first line. For here, it has two chief complaints and all the triples. Once we load this, it will give the ICD-10 code saying that your patient has the following ICD-10 codes. And that is the demo. You can also try with a different triple file. And coming to things that I have learned, of all the many things, these are the important things. One is the ontology building. In fact, I have built a small ontology of the disease hierarchy. And the second one being writing advanced Sparkle queries, which includes the subqueries and inferencing techniques. And thanks. That was fun. Credits to Sujan and this guy Rajesh, he helped me in developing the UI and all, and I got this team from that. Now this my journey for starts. Thank you guys.
Alright, so how do you know quality?
Right now what I did is that I have written the triples myself, and I included some subclasses kind of thing, and not the direct classes which are being mentioned in the ICD-10 code, and see how the system is performing. And it was giving me the correct results. There are some things that I still need to do, let me show you this small example. So in this particular example, if you see that here it is being mentioned that with unspecified complications. We are still not sure of how to encode this thing. So as an initial step for that, what we did is that we have just deleted that part and encoded modeled for all the remaining classes.
So we're doing a project on identifying cyberbullying from Twitter feeds. So why is this a problem? So there's a couple different reasons. One is, you know, victims of bullying get lower grades and they're absent from school more. So there's an educational aspect to it. There's also, you know, victims of cyberbullying and bullying in general also have a higher rate of depression, you know, suicidal thoughts. Look in the news and hear stories about you know, kids committing suicide almost weekly over bullying. So it's a problem. So we thought we'd try to use our project to identify these online. So what did we build to do it? We broke the problem into three stages. So the first stage is using the Twitter streaming API to just get some tweets. So, you know, out of all the stupid tweets on Twitter, you know, how can we identify things that are a threat for the first stage? So, you see here, so here's all the stupid tweets. If you go to the next slide. So, what we built into our harvester was user mentions. So we're looking for tweets that are directed towards one other user. So it has to have a user mention in the tweet. The second thing we did is, by default, the Twitter streaming API only does keyword selections. So if you send it a phrase like kill you, you'll return any tweet containing you or the word kill, which, you know, if you're looking for something specific, you would have a ton for that mentioned you, but not that. So in our harvester, we throw out anything that doesn't match our phrase. And then a word list. So there's been some research done on this previously from at the University of Wisconsin. And so we got a word list from them of common words that occur in cyberbullying. So we fed that into our harvester. So you see here, we get, I don't know if you guys can read these or not, but so we whittle it down once there. So the second stage is, once we get those, how do we classify it? So we use the Weka machine learning library in Java, and Red Hat OpenShift to put a web service on top of it. But so from the ones we've harvested, first we pre-process them. So we take out the usernames because we don't want the classifier keying off that. We also, there aren't any examples up here, but we take out the URLs and anything else like that. So we just get, you know, the text of the tweet. We went through it manually. We made 1,000 tweets of a training set, and we got another 1,000 tweet test set so we could score our accuracy and see. So you can see here, these are all the ones that our harvester picked up on, and then, you know, but out of all of these, there's only one that's an actual threat that we found. Okay. So underlying all of this, we built on top of the Weka machine learning library. There's a bunch of different classification algorithms you can use. We tried out four of them and ran it through. The best was the Naive Bayes classifier. Accuracy of 91%. Actually, that's a little bit lower than what they, you know, advertise. And we think that's due more to like the short lengths in Twitter and how, you know, there's a lot of abbreviations and slang terms. But still, 91% is pretty good. So from that stage, we have a web dashboard. And Kurt, what do you think about that?
So we put this onto, we had the harvester and the classifier, and the dashboard is just kind of does the every all the functionality after that. So what it is it's a web app, and you can access the link there if anyone wants to see it now. It's connected to MongoLab, which is a database, MongoDB as a service. And we use this because it transfers and receives all data as JSON. So it's good for like a lot of computation, a lot of data transferring. And a little bit about what this does before I go on to an example. It gets all the classified tweets that Michael has stored in there from his classifier, and it displays them to the user. Just a list of them, and lets you page through those. Since all of the classified tweets, there's maybe 1 out of 10 that actually is classified as a threat, so we only display ones as threats just for the application. We want to find threatening tweets, so you won't see any non-threatening tweets on there. And then what we do is we take each tweet, if the user wants more info, and we run it through Twitter search API, get back 5 tweets from both the from user to the to user, and 5 tweets from the to user to the from user. So that gets us 10 tweets from their conversation history. And then we score those both with Michael's classifier. You put it up as a service, so we can score each of the history tweets on a classification level. And we used a sentiment classifier from Unclassify. It's just kind of a generic one. So we'll do an example now. This is based on, I don't know if you caught it before, but one of the tweets that he had on his example that he caught. And this is a conversation between them. So I don't know if you want to run back and show them the first tweet. If it's back on your slide so they can see where it came from. So this one here, this is the tweet we're getting history for. So you see it's pretty vulgar there. Definitely gets a high threat score. And then we we get the history, we can see, as humans, we can see that these guys are just joking around, you know, they're said something mean, but then they're just laughing at each other and saying, you know, lies, love you, stuff like that. So we can see that this is not a threat, that user A is not bullying user B. So go to the next slide and we'll see. This is how the Michaels classifier would score this. So it would classify a couple of these as true, unknown, but overall we see that it's mostly just, you know, like not threatening tweets. So we give it a low score here, and the score represents how likely user A is bullying user B. So this, the way the algorithm works is that it takes a score based on how many tweets are bullying out of the total here, and then it counteracts it with how many tweets are bullying from here. So if they're both bullying each other or saying rude things to each other, we can assume that there's just like a friendly interaction, or maybe it's not one way. That's what we're determining there. So then we run through the sentiment classifier, and this works in the same way, and we see here that most of them are positive sentiment, so we get a low score here. So we can prove, or at least guess, that this user is not bullying the other user. So although we saw, based on the text from the first tweet, that it's vulgar and it's clearly some kind of threat, if we look at the history, we can easily see that there's no threat being made between these two users. So before I go into results, we also considered a location score and an age difference score. But the way we envisioned it was to use the age difference of the two users, and then statistically by, you know, what ages are more likely to bully. So, you know, like a 20-year-old would be more likely to bully than someone about 40 to 50. But we didn't realize that Twitter doesn't provide a structured age. So we have the algorithm coded, we don't have any data to hook up to. So that could be something in future work to maybe if you port it to Facebook or something like that, where we can get an age. And the location score, the reason why we don't have that is because I wanted to use the embedded metadata from where the tweets were sent. And the reason I wanted to do that was because we could then see if the two users were close during the time that they're interacting with harsh tweets. So if say, user A was bullying user B, and they're close together, then there's a possibility that it could turn into more than just a mental exchange there. So I'll let Michael go over the results here, and we'll do the difference.
So is there any use of explicit use of semantics here?
Well, it's implicit, right? So the just the fact that you know, we're checking that there is a conversation history there, so it's users that, and bullying's likely to occur with people that know each other, right? So, like if there was an example at the end, at the beginning, where, you know, our thing triggered on a guy that was, you know, cussing out McDonald's.
But there's no sort of, you know, foxonomy or lack of words or anything like ontology or some sort of term classification or anything like that.
So what we did, you know, we can classify, identify the potential threatening harassment tweets, score them at a level, and at the end provide a user interface so somebody can go through and investigate these threats and see if it is if it's really an instance of somebody threatening somebody else or not. Future work. We'd like to, so one of the things that came up later on in the project was we realized that the classifier was trained on those first filter words, and so you need some sort of either more general, combine it with more general classifier or a sentiment analyzer to really detect bullying, and then automate the dashboards. You'll see we've got about you know, thousands of threatening tweets. We're trying to go through them one at a time, but we really need to automate that part too, and broaden the data set. So, and what we used from class was the implicit semantics between the two Twitter users.
So we're still talking about fighting and, you know, bringing up conflict between the two users. And then based on the scores on the right-hand side, we see high levels of, you know, estimating that this could be potential. So what this does is it just maybe sends it to the next level, because this is a big problem, a big thing to solve that Wimbo and Lou are working on. So this is just one classifier that confirms that this could go to a higher level based on their history, that they are, you know, fighting multiple times, not just one bad tweet to analyze. So another example. You can click on any of these and load their histories and score the history of their tweets. But the example I'm going to show is this one here. This is the example that we had on the slideshow. So we see that, again, it's, you know, a vulgar tweet up here, but based on the sentiment classifier and the threat classifier, it shows that the scores here are low because their history shows that they're just, you know, laughing around and just joking, and it's not actually a threatening tweet. So, but, I mean, you can, we don't have a lot of good samples of the threat classifier working well, because as we described before, it's trained on just the harvested data set based on, you know, the words that we extracted. So that's a little inaccurate, but you see a little bit better of how it works based on the sentiment history. You can scroll through all these though and look at a bunch. But that's basically how it works.
So what is the base example? So that true thing is the base example, I think, of that one?
What's that?
Of bullying?
You mean the one from the, that was, I think that one ended up on like the third page, the one that from the slides. Yeah, this one where, you know, just looking at the tweet, you know, it's pretty obvious, you know, that's, you know, user A threatening user B. And then when you load it, you find out that they're just
so this score here is the text of this tweet up here, so it shows that it's obviously negative. And then these two classify the threat and the sentiment analysis of the history.
Yeah, but this ultimately is not really bullying, right?
Right. That's why you see the low scores here.
Right. So did you find some good examples where it actually was significant bullying case?
The first one I showed was the best example we had.
I wouldn't say significant. Like, it wasn't like how I envisioned it in my head, you know, finding. We found some where it's like, all right, yeah, I can see, you know, you definitely want to check these guys out, because, you know, it's going to end up in a fist fight. But we didn't find any
Is it because you've done, how many, 1,000 users is what you've done?
Yeah, we did 25,000 is what we looked through. And so that was from, we ran our harvester for a couple of hours a month ago. We got 25,000, so you know, if we had more data, more time, I think we can narrow down further.
Because it would be nice to see whether a naive technique would have found bullying that you did not find, and the other way around. So it would be nice to see whether the technique that you have is more insightful than something that you look at just a few tweets or other, you know. There should be some baseline, and then you compare this baseline. That is what you would be adding to it.
I think what this does really well is proves that one tweet is, one user is not bullying another, as opposed to prove that he is bullying. Like this example, you know, it's by just the text, you couldn't decide that. History, just a small caption of history, you can see the three of his friends.
Yeah, good. Very well presented. That's what I would say. It was probably the best presentation so far.
So I was going to try and do creating semantic links using NLP. later on attaching the learning to NLP. I've changed a lot. I attached everything to NLP, but as the progress progressed, I found that that's not actually true. So you do the semantic stuff. Yeah, well, it's just we're good. I'm probably won't touch on backgrounds. We've all seen it before. Same thing. Motivation, goal, approach, we'll do a demo, results, evaluation, assessment, future work, conclusions. Background, same stuff. So machine learning's come a long way. We got Siri, IBM, semantic webs. It's not new, but it's finally getting traction. And I didn't know it actually started in the 60s, the semantic networking. But, you know, the idea is bring order to disorder on the web, try to make things structured. So motivation for our project was, so everything in Wilson can be automated. There's got to be a way to automate ontology construction, or like a lifetime kind of semantic bridging between things on the fly, right? And the motivation was cost. So web programs 8,000, the main expert 77. If you can do half of that work automated, you can save your cost for small business. Then you just pay undergrad students to verify your results. There's actually a paper called AutoCons, the cost estimate model for ontology engineering. So it seems like it's kind of costly to make papers on it to see how much it costs to make ontology. Some of it is just personal knowledge. I'm not a real web kind of person, make person. I want to get personal knowledge in this field of computer science, because it's not one of my main areas of computer science. So the goal was, can we use NLP and existing search engines to generate semantic links between user queries? Just a simple kind of goal, like basically the buildings of a search engine. So the approach, well, so take a look back, so what exists today? Stanford Parser, Stanford NER, we've been through those before, so we know what those are. We have search engines like Bing and Google, people using doing this time today, probably. Then I looked at the existing technologies. What did people try to do before? So it was ProBase by Microsoft Research. They basically had a usable kind of database, I guess you'd call it, ontology, but they haven't released their newest code yet. Know-it-all was kind of the same direction, but both of them were more standalone. They basically had people program up these ontologies and search through from there. So my approach was, well, how can we do this? How can we try to use on the live, like on the fly kind of semantic links? So I figured, well, Stanford's done most of the work, so let's kind of just piggyback off their work. Let's try and let them do the heavy lifting. Let them parse out the words, find the NERs, find the POS. Let's try and let them do the heavy work. Then we take the results and look at them and send those results to a search engine, basically looking at like the POS tags, because we don't want to really care about adjectives and things in the query. And then repeat the process until we build like a certain level of trees that the user determines is, we don't want to go 10,000 depths, keep getting like a circle link kind of. So I decided to use MATLAB for array handling, because when I started out, I thought it was going to have a huge array thing. Turns out we didn't have an array, so I could use a different language. But the approach was this, basically build a MATLAB core code, then make it to where everything's functions so that the code can be given out as a toolkit later on. So basically, we have a MATLAB program that the user puts in a string. It runs through a function. The function interacts with the Stanford anonymity recognizer. It sends back a list, an array of tagged entities. MATLAB program then takes those tagged objects, sends it to the POS, the part of speech, when we find out if they're nouns, adjectives, verbs, whatever. It comes back with a tag of these are the nouns, the verbs, or adjectives. And from there, the MATLAB program only searches for N and S's, so it'd be noun, comma, singulars. And that usually is like your words like right, state, people, things like that, actual objects, not like the, not articles, things like that. Goes to the web crawler. The web crawler actually turned me more difficult than I thought. But it goes through, basically will interact with Bing because Google had problems interacting with MATLAB. And actually parses a Bing search on that and looks at the first hit trying to exploit Bing's already done, not page rank, but how they actually rank their pages. And then from that information back, it goes to MATLAB. You start getting a tree structure, adding the tree. Was it a good, basically parse the links, look at the links, what was in those links, are they able to be added to the tree? So I'm going to try a live demo real quick. So it's going to run. So what's doing right now is it actually took in a query. So the query was that right says a professor named Dr. Robin Schiff. He makes $140,000. I just put in some money number there because money came out as a difficult thing for the program to actually figure out, like, what is that? So actually, but I say it's changed their page since I ran the slides, because those two ones weren't on there. So what's doing on now is it's basically, it came through and found right state was part of the NER. saw that Rice State has a .edu domain check. .edu is usually universities, right? So Cal State says, okay, we have university. Now it starts looking at Rice State's main page and find the noun, not singulars, on the page. You have words like a link that says athletics, Rice State athletics, a link that says academics. There's a link on there at a point that says Columbus, a link that says sports. Stores all those, then further parses down through those links, and it keeps looking for the same kind of trends.
You're talking about Luke said just the RightState.edu website, or just generally anywhere?
Right now, it basically took the first NER object it found, it was Right State, sent that to a Bing query, took the first hit from the Bing site, and looked at that site, and said, okay, the domain of that is .edu. So I had to start somewhere, and I didn't know how to, I didn't think of like how far did I want to go look through the pages. I figured we'll grab the first hit first and look at the first hit on.
But what is so semantic about that? What is that, what is the rationale? Why would you justify other than just simply saying the first result is, what search engine is, which is not semantic, the one that you're using is not semantic. There are some semantic part of Bing, but not the basic search. And furthermore, once you go to second, but below that, what kind of contextual relationship you're making from where you started to where you're going in your down the tree?
So, you're absolutely right. If you query a page that has nothing to do with what you're looking at, there's no semantic link to it. But the idea of the program was, can we use like a non-semantic website like Bing, which has a little bit of semantics, but not a lot, right? And start building our own semantic, basically grouping from that page.
Okay, but how? How is that really being done? What is the argument that indeed this leads to any more semantics than getting some depth first search or word breadth first search, whatever you're doing, leads to a website?
So the way I envisioned it was, you go to the Rice State website, right? On that site are just a bunch of words. The computer has no idea what any of those words are, right? You got academics, what is that, athletics, right? So you have a mix of nouns, adjectives, verbs, parts of English on that page. So, grabbing the nouns, you have an object relationship now. Like, now, on Rice State's website is a word called athletics, right? Well, that's a web address, so let's go search what that web address came from.
But I thought you started out earlier with some objective, like Rice State University, or my name, or salary.
Yeah, so
from there, you reach athletics, that means you didn't really do anything interesting.
So what it's doing right now is, the end goal of the project wasn't to, give you a link back to a query. It was have a user put in a query. So it's not like an end product, it's more of like a toolkit. So what the program does, it allows you to put in a query, and from there it can start building semantic links between what it found in that query.
But using that, you're not defend the semantic aspect of semantic link. How is it that you are putting, that's fine, I'll accept that. Point is, show me what is a semantic link here. When you start with something, say a person's name and salary, and you go to athletics where I have nothing to do with athletics, mm-hmm. What is semantic about it? How are you? Even if this is not an end, user tool or a thing, even if it's an infrastructure, that's also fine. Tell me how you're making progress towards doing anything semantic.
So the reason the Rice State one came up was because Rice State was the first NER detected in that string.
That's what right. It came up
so,
fine.
Yeah, so
because your objective of finding semantic link, how did you win?
So then it goes to the next object in the NER, and it finds your name, right? If you just Google your name, right, it comes across with a medical doctor. There's a medical doctor on the first hit, right?
No, so it does not. Check anyway.
It's not as testing it. So when the NER finds it,
huh?
It finds.
No, just put it with chef.
So the code actually.
Yeah, now just see what you get.
Yeah, so with the code, when the Stanford parser actually finds your name, it actually finds it denotes the doctor as part of the name.
No, this does not. I mean, that's fine. But
yeah, since it's based off the Stanford parser, when the parser sends back the NER, doctor is part of your name.
Here, so right there is a big failure of semantic aspect, at least the way you look at it. If you had any semantics to it, then you would recognize that doctor is a PhD doctor and doctor is a medical doctor. And given that that semantics is missing, this is totally taking you on the wrong path. That means you are losing all the semantics. Where is the semantics?
True. Had you had semantics, like, had you started with the semantic background to begin with, if you're trying to build your semantic background from the ground up, right, with no...
Okay. You are trying to build a semantic from the background.
You would know the
doctor. How would you reach that objective? How would you reach the objective of reaching my name or Michelle as opposed to somebody else? I don't see how you reach that objective.
So that's a good question. So what happens is, because doctor is tagged from NER as part of the name, right, so it believes that your name is actually Dr. Amishet, even though it's just Amishet, right? When you bring it, you'll get this page first. But the code takes the previous NERs that was found and actually adds them in the search query. So what the code will do is now it's going to put, because the first NER tag is right state, right? So assuming a left to right kind of field of sentence, unless you,
if
so what it'll do is it'll put right state at the end.
Right,
then,
wonderful. Then the whole right state itself is missing here.
No, so
in
this one
point.
I just typed in.
Huh?
This one I just typed in. The code, if you look back at the MATLAB code, you look back at the code, so let me get to the actual second tree it made. So this is the second query it sent. So what it did was, it took the first NER object was right state, and it took the object it found was Dr. Amish Smith, took that, added the first NER to it, now it knows that it found a university, and then the rest of it is like changed. But the rest of it goes to Noesis after that. So by using the first NER in conjunction with the second NER was tagged, it was able to locate your name off the page, off the first site, instead of going to Dr. Amishet, the doctor, the medical doctor, or putting right state at the end, it was able to link it to the university.
Right, but what was your objective? To use non-semantic thing, draw that, and from there, create some form of creating semantics. How did you get that? What did you achieve in that context?
So I guess I thought when I was doing that, I achieved that, because if the code just grabbed the NER by itself, Dr. Shep, it wouldn't find it. It wouldn't find, unless you call it a bunch of pages, it wouldn't
actually
find it.
The point is, it seems like it is making the things worse than making it better.
I don't see how you make it worse. That's fine. I don't see how it's making it worse, but...
Oh, where are you making progress towards a person who is at right state, or a person who is me, or a person wherever you started out with, and creating a semantic around it. And semantics would, as you know, we have discussed at length, semantics would mean disambiguation, knowing this is different from that, synonyms, co-occurrences, any number of different things you can do. But the point is that here, I'm trying to get a sense of how you structured your process of crawling, of using those tools, such that the end result produces what you claim and what you put in the title as semantic link of any sort. That is what I'm trying to get, and that's what I'm debating.
So the next, what you could have done is once the trees were generated, mm-hmm. The next step in the program would have been to search the trees for identical words, may not be the right word for that, but identical groupings. So by searching that, then you would see.
To be able to do identical grouping again, you'll have to go beyond simply a single word. And at this point, from what I understand here, you're really not set up yet to deal with any type of typed information, persons, places, roles, physician, academic,
sure.
None of those things I see here that are available to your tools, to be able to do those groupings if you wanted to.
Sure, yeah. It's not there yet. Right, but basically I started off with high hopes. I ended up building a foundational basis, more like a research toolkit, to try and build, to see what actually happens with it. So it wasn't designed actually in this way. I thought actually by using the first NERs with it, you started to narrow down your searches, so you have these trees at the end of the day that then are related to each other, as opposed to trees that are not related, because they use the same NERs to search, to narrow down your searches, to try and build a semantic link to it. So when I ran this query when I was making a website, ironically enough, Columbus Sports wasn't listed on RISE's website. So now apparently they've changed it, so now it picked up those as objects for RISE's website. But like I said earlier, it basically found RISE State, the search for the EDU domain. So NER comes back saying it's organization, Stanford did that, found his organization. The .edu domain means it's a university. And that's something I hard coded in there. I looked at Gov, Common Commercial, yeah, I looked at the extension, MOBI is a mobile web, those kind of things. You had to hard code that in there because people know what EDU means. So when it comes in, it basically is able to use Dr. Ramachet and Rice State. And again, when I ran it, using the same query I just showed, it actually found people in the OESIS as part of the crawling page we added that query. When I ran this time, to pick up on that page. So, you have to use filters to remove unwanted words. So words in the links like sites, images, pages, directories, those are words that, there's a bunch of links on the website that has those in them. And you'll get trees that just grow without any information because it keeps linking back to itself. So I filtered those unwanted words out for now. And there's also words like web apps too, which is not a really word. But the idea for a further benefit of the program was to basically go to a dictionary and search for words that actually exist, like a language dictionary. So the program also removed links that would link back to themselves. So if you go to a website, there's almost always a link that links back to the parent website. So that would just get you a circle tree of basically repeated links. So the next list was chopped out of that so you wouldn't have a repeated link in a tree. So to test the code, I ran it with 5-level depth. And because I want to see if depth level, if users saying go 5 levels or 100 levels will make a difference. So I ran with 5 levels, and the main tree completed around 48 seconds. So the first NER object completed 48 seconds. And it only contained 2 levels. Testing it with 100 levels, it took 80 seconds to parse through the rest of the 100 codes, or the links to determine, keep going levels in those links to determine whether it was part of the main program or not. Turns out what you get after on Rice State's website is a bunch of links that keep repeating themselves. So the level, at the end of the day, was still 2. So by increasing the depth, does that make any difference? But that may not be entirely correct with other pages, because some pages may not have links back to themselves. So I'm just going to find words that aren't any S's, but that's kind of not the evaluation error. End up doing a hand trace. So I made a hand trace, print out the web source, looked at the websites, compared what the program found to the ones it filtered out, see if it was linked, because there was no other way to evaluate it any other way but a manual trace. Because since you're building it from the ground up, you have nothing to compare it to. So the assessment was, basically, can we use NLP in existing search engines to generate semantic link between queries? The program showed a proof of concept, but as Akshat pointed out, the semantics to it is the next step. Like, this is just getting a foundation for, I think these things are linked together using a part-of-speech tagger and letting Stanford do the heavy lifting. Now that you have these trees, you can then look for objects among the trees to try and locate basically maybe commonality between the trees. And then from there, this can build it. Is it actually a failure? Not exactly. The program does crawl the web for tagging yards using Stanford to basically find what it needs, and it creates the trees that you can search for later. So was it, as I envisioned it, to end that? It became more of a toolkit to...
You see, the point here is that doing that part has nothing to do with what we are doing in this course or anything of that nature. So the defense that you probably want to make, if there is one, is to focus on, well, how do you constrain the search in any way? What kind of knowledge is used? What kind of, I see basically crawling, I see NER, use of existing tool, but then beyond that, how did you achieve any semantic objective or any other objective that you had? I don't understand that.
So the main goal would have been to take it to the next step, which I ran out of time to do, was to then look at the trees and try and determine semantic links from the trees, because this is the foundation for it.
Let's say, even if you want to talk about partial success, okay?
Okay.
Let's forget that you ran out of time and all that. But what did you expect? I mean, what was the objective? Where did you expect to find, and create the semantics out of whatever you have? That is the thing that I understand. Meaning, you did what you did. Point is, what was the objective and how can not just something was implemented, but what implemented with what purpose and how? What would you have seen as an example? Let's say even fictitious, made up.
Okay, so.
With the thing that your approach you're taking.
Okay. So I thought, let's say the end goal, let's say that it's all done and everything works. What it would do is you would type in a string query, like right? So if the computer doesn't know any of that stuff, right? We assume that. So you type in the query. The query then looks for the entity objects.
No, but you know, it's not a good, I don't think it's reasonable for you to say that the computer doesn't know anything. In the following caveat, yes, computer doesn't know anything. Your program by itself doesn't know anything. That is true. And anybody's program won't know anything by itself. And that is true. But remember, in this class, we discuss at length such things as using background knowledge base. So if you go to Freebase, we have discussed that. You go to DBpedia, you can go to Google Knowledge Base. Any number of things that we have discussed in the class, it would have basically taken RightState as an entity, a background knowledge, which would have a type of several things or various things. It is a university, it is in Dayton, whatever variety of remember extensively I emphasize in the class or relationships that this RightState, that string that you have, would have to other objects that would give you a meaning to it. That exploitation is what I was looking for. That is what I'm, that's why I'm raising this concerns.
So sure, but then again, it takes people to do those domains. So if you go to Google Knowledge Search, right?
It takes people, but the DBpedia is already out there. It doesn't take any more people to do DBpedia. It's there.
But it's not like update, right? I mean, it's not like it's a done product and nothing's ever going to be put back into it. So it takes people to maintain
it. DBpedia is maintained automatically, regularly.
Yeah. So the idea I had was, can you just use a non-semantic search engine to try and generate trees, right? Using NLP technology to generate the links between the trees, and then say, okay, now from these trees we have, which are clearly linked somehow because they're in a query together, and we know these trees have commonality among themselves based on what we found. So would it be possible then to look at those trees and say, okay, well, here's a person named Dr. Amichet, right?
That is what I'm not seeing. So I see
yes,
all
so
the other things. Okay,
yes.
That's fine.
So that was the next step.
If you wanted to show and do anything more semantics, that's what I...
Yeah, so that was the next step.
Just numbers.
So what if the two things weren't related? Would you be able to recognize they're not related? Or are you assuming that if they're queried together, that they have some relation?
That's a good question. So I assume that if they're in a query, they're together. But then if you researched the trees and found no commonality among them, you would know then that they were together. Like it was just two independent objects that had nothing really to each other.
So what kind of relationship are you trying to build? Like are you trying to develop a set of triples?
Yeah, pretty much it was to develop from the ground up. Like develop these things. Can you do it on the fly by developing them without using a semantic background knowledge ahead of time? The NLP and then trying to use a non-semantic search to build. It's trying to, on the fly, build your own triples. No, that makes sense. So, like, in the test case I ran, you had Wright State's a school that has these objects, right? You have Dr. Amichet, who apparently works at Wright State because he's in the same query. So now between there, you know that Wright State's a school, because in both trees it came across as that.
Right.
And then you know Dr. works there, and now the group called No East is looking at something else, and he's apparently part of that. So from there, you could then dig into that. So, does that answer the question? Ish. Okay. Cool. So I already talked about the future work. Trying to use auto filters. Generating links between tree nodes.
So I have a quick question.
Yeah.
So I mean, one of the main things that you look for in a semantic search is to be able to answer these questions. So if I was to say, find me all professors at Wright State, would it be able to find out? Would the results that contain Dr. Amichet, or how are you processing is what I'm trying to ask.
So, good question. So the next step would be basically to put these in you just have these trees, put them in the database, right? And then your query goes to the engine and says, find all teachers at Wright State. Well, look, Wright State's a school. I'm going to find all professors there. Apparently these guys are part of Wright State, and they're doctors, graduate teachers, so they're a part of Wright State, so let me find people that are there. Now they may find some people that work here that may not be professors, which would be the next step to try and filter those results out. But yeah, so the idea was basically build like the foundation for a search engine, like try and get the knowledge for your semantic search engine by using a non-semantic approach to it. Mm-hmm. That answered. in the background. So then you just type it accordingly, like you would in Google. Press go and it does all this on its own. And it comes back. Yeah, so it's like it's building the like foundation to build a search engine on. It's not like it's a done thing. Like you just you don't see this happen. It does it on its own. So yeah, so basically what I got was out of it was a toolkit that anybody can use that can go through and parse these things and build these build the trees of semantic links, but it's actually the point they're not semantic links, they're just trees of obviously that are thought to be put together. So what I learned was basically semantic technology is useful, but NLP can't do it all yet, at least. There's no benefit to doing all of it yet. And I think auto ontology generation is possible. It's difficult, but it's like possible.
I think the challenge is not that NLP can't do it all. And here, the problem is that you did not demonstrate what NLP can actually do. And it can, some. But the point here is that you put a lot of faith in NLP, but channeling towards semantics is what I think is the missing point.
So, did you see the talk in 2006 from Peter Norvig against Brandon Lee? Did you read that? About how he basically was grilling him over how comes semantic web is useful?
Yes, right. And did you see my blog that responded to Peter Norvig?
So he's changed his view.
He changed his view, and that's what Google does now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so they actually started, so he changed views against it back in 2006, wholeheartedly against it. He's changed his view. But his idea is still like thought of in the community as basically there's a lot of thought of doing a semantic web. And when I took class, I thought, no, we didn't need it because we could do it through NLP, text everything on the page, right? Figure it all out. Clearly we can do it, so why can't the computer do it? That's when you start looking at NLP technology, and it's not there yet to do that. So semantic web is a tool that you can use to further strengthen NLP.
Mm.
So that's what I got on this. It's not a cure-all for everything.
Mm.
That was about it. Any other questions?
All right. So, guy, who's left? Somebody left? No, he's taking an eye. A couple of people who really want to work hard and come back. Don't give up yet. Okay, that's fine. All right, what else? Any comments? Anything you guys want to add? Anybody wants to discuss anything about their what they have done in the course, how they have done, or their feedback to me? You're all welcome. You can meet me tomorrow or of the nature. I'll propose it over the weekend, and you guys will then have your grades. More importantly, I hope you really learned, found something challenging. Maybe some of you will pursue this further. Maybe some of you will do thesis in this area. Maybe some of you will apply this to other techniques, right? What I see from my perspective is that if you look at just simply the topics of the projects. A number of them are very state of the art, meaning while in this course I would not have expected you guys to have completed the research and written the paper and published the paper, but if that were to be pursued, they would absolutely lead to something along that line. Problems are the latest in many cases, at least half of the cases. They are actually being pursued by industry as we speak. They want to have a solution for some of the projects we do. For example, ICD-10 coding, we happen to have actually a funded project with a company that is actually making commercial product using some of the research that we are doing, including what was in the class. Well, if it's successful, then they'll be trying it out, testing it out, see if it works, right? So it's clearly kind of very state of the art kind of thing. you look at mHealth, one of the fastest growing area of industry in the growth context. Issues from research perspective, issues like harassment or cyberbullying and all that are state of the art. Like we have a proposal to NSF pending right now that, you know, seeks funding to do that kind of research. As far as, for example, coordination activities on social media, well, we actually have a funded project that is going on now. If you look at understanding electronic medical records, a lot of there are at least 7 companies out there that are getting the products out in the market now, and two of them, including the company we work with, is doing the work in that area of combining NLP with semantic web techniques, with ontologies in particular. So the interesting thing here is that you guys ended up working on projects that are very, very state of the art, and you have had all different level of outcomes, but by and large they were excellent. They were exceptions, and that the team worked very well. I mean, I'm really glad. I hope that this is a routine thing that you guys are engaged in. Number of people, some of you interacted with more senior researchers, maybe about 3-4 projects had that thing, either they had a senior researcher in the project or they contacted outside. That ecosystem, so when Chris Welty was here, I took out, 8 of us went out for dinner. I took out deliberately my students so that they can interact with this person in the industry and say, learn what is expected, what is successful. So the emphasis on empirically driven research, research was, something that he pointed out, saying that you guys do that, we do that. And if you look at us, you should ask your own question, yourself, where are you doing that empirical? Meaning, do you have an application in mind? Do you have data? Do you think that if you are very successful, that somebody can make a product or service or build jobs and all that? The answer in about half of the cases is yes. The other is, working with real data and those things I say is very important. Teamwork. There is practically nothing in the industry where a single person works alone. So interactions and working with other people, this was very important. And this is going to be very important, so they will test you on that. Of course, you will have to make sure that your programmer's skills are up to the par, because many of the companies will test you on basic programming things. But beyond that, if you pass that, the chance that you will do well in the real world is high if you continue along this path. Yeah. Other thing I wanted to do was for some of you at least to have something in your portfolio, something in your resume where you can say, I worked on this project, and the project description says something very meaningful. It's something not a class project. It is a project that has an actual real world value, right? And if you put that and say, I processed on 100,000 tweets, or I processed on 5,000 records and XYZ, that has a lot of value. People are looking for that. So if you look at, for example, recruit people who hire, make hiring decision, for typical master's and bachelor's resume, the first thing is the internship. Have you done internship or have you done real world projects? So you can think of this as a substitute for internship kind of thing. The kind of thing you did is like an internship, actually. Just mini internship. And just yesterday I read an article Google does, and now many other companies do extensive analysis of their hiring practices and what works and what doesn't work. So the article that I saw yesterday, I shared with those students, that they have decided now that SAT scores and GPA are not a good indicator and they don't rank that high, that doesn't mean that you don't want to get A grades here. You should work hard to get an A grade. But what you're going to get from this course should be, or what you should get from this course is not that grade, but the actual learning that you did, and that you know, that will really sell. So what is it that when they are not looking for SAT score and they're looking for, they'll do their own test, and you need to pass that. But beyond that, they're looking for this, something like this projects. I've been in companies and I've done startups, so I hired a lot of people, right? And that's what I would also do. I was not afraid of hiring somebody who had 3.4 GPA. That was not a major issue. I did not let go somebody because he had 3.4 GPA or 3.3 GPA. Under 3 years, I would be cautious. Okay, but whether it is 3.4 or 3.8 doesn't make a heck of a difference just by itself. Then it's all the rest of the things, and these are the kind of stuff that we have done in the class that I hope will come handy for you. I also hope that for some of you, you would choose to pursue thesis option if you're doing graduate studies, because at least my experience shows that thesis options give you much higher paying and much better jobs. The difference is the following. Walmart needs to hire an IT guy and a master's, and the Target needs to hire, and Meyer needs to hire these kind of guys, and CACI needs to hire those guys, right? But between the people that they need to hire and the people that, let's say, Google, startup in Silicon Valley, Facebook, Twitter, any of the IT company, Amazon, that they need to hire, right? The difference is substantial. And that is that second class of second class of companies that need to hire is substantially different. And that is where I hope, if you do thesis, you'll be better prepared to do something along that line and be successful there, and you will get a chance to do that. So think about that issue also. I had, as I said, after bachelor's, people can get paid as low as 40K and as high as 70K. For master's, you can get paid as low as 55K and as high as 120K. Look at that distinction. So this degree is a degree. That's not true. The difference is vast. And understand what will it, what can put you in that higher category. All right. Glad to have you guys here, and you're always welcome to stop by even after the course is ended.